Thank you for inviting me here, Professor Sethuraman, Chancellor, Vice Chancellor. I had a tour of your campus. To me, the most impressive thing I saw was the biotech work being done here. In fact, I was really blown away by it, and I don't know anything about biotech, right? I'm learning. I'm new to this field. I almost thought we should start a biotech company here with the amount of talent that's being produced here. Anyway, so with that, I'll actually, that sets a beginning of, I'm going to ask you a question here. Raise your hands if you are going to graduate here and get a job within the 30 kilometer radius. Is any one of you going to stay here? That's maybe two or three, right? Maybe one. So we have actually created all these universities, world-class universities, in places like here, in the heart of rural Tanjavur district, right? Near, and it's been in operation for more than 30 years now. Still, what is lacking is we don't have industries to make use of all the talent that comes out. In practice, what it means is the university then becomes what I call a talent vacuum cleaner. You suck all the talent, send them to Chennai, send them to Bangalore, or send them to Silicon Valley, send them somewhere but not here, right? That's what the universities have become, actually a lot of our universities. And so when a university exists and a corresponding industry doesn't exist, then the university becomes a talent funnel to someone else. And this is one of the problems that always exercised me when I was from my student days to when I worked for a brief period in Qualcomm. I used to think that, you know, every person that works somewhere else, I mean, high-tech job, you know, every job in Zoho supports maybe five other jobs that are not high-tech. The Zoho job can be called high-tech, but there are five other jobs that are not high-tech. So the fact that all of you will go on to some high-tech career means that those five jobs will not exist here. And this region needs those jobs. This area needs those jobs. And those five jobs are the people who could not afford to go to college like this or may not have the smarts to go through a program like this, all of that, right? They also need jobs. And the fact that we don't have those industries is a major problem that always exercises my mind. And the corresponding other problem that always used to bother me is, when I was born in 1968, Chennai had a population maybe about 30 lakhs. Now Chennai has a population more than 1 crore and growing fast still. At the present rate of growth, maybe Chennai will have 2 crores in another 10, 15 years. Even more unlivable. Even more unlivable. Bangalore is heading towards 2 crores. Mumbai is already, I think, crossed 2 crores. Mumbai maybe go to 3 or 4 crores. If you are planning to move to Mumbai, please don't. Save them, right? But yet, guess where all of you are going, right? Most of you are going to go to Chennai or Bangalore or Mumbai or Pune or Delhi. With about 75% probability, that's where you are going. Maybe 25% of you will go abroad. But when you go abroad also, you will end up in the same similarly congested cities. New York City or San Francisco or one of those places. While there's all these places here, our very own Tanjavur, that does not have access to the talent anymore. The same talent that's produced here still doesn't work here. So this has been a problem that I've thought about it for a long time. You can say I've been thinking about this for 20 years, ever since the beginning of this company. And I came to some conclusions and I will briefly summarize. I believe that the entire, India, we have borrowed what I would call the Anglo-Saxon model. That's basically a British and American model, originally British and then later perfected by Americans. That's the model we are implicitly on. That's the model we have borrowed here. And this model actually involves this type of talent being sucked out of smaller towns, rural areas, funneled into giant metros and giant companies, that model. There is a different model actually available. The countries that most exemplify the different model that I have studied would be Germany, Switzerland, and Japan to an extent, to a lesser extent. And I, even as early as 1997, I realized Japan has a lot more to teach us. We have a lot more to learn from them for our particular conditions in India than the US. Yet, because of our fluency in the English language, we naturally gravitate towards the US model. But that's not very suitable for our conditions, right? And so, a lot of our, you know, if you think Zoho is very unorthodox, actually Zoho will look much more orthodox when you view it from a Japan or Germany or Switzerland perspective. In other words, if you understand a German company, if you understand a Swiss company, you understand a Japanese company, Zoho will make a lot more sense. In fact, a lot of people think Zoho University is a highly innovative model. When you look at the German apprenticeship model, it's not that innovative. Actually, this is what German companies have done for a long time. Even today in Germany, a relatively small proportion of the population actually goes to college. The remaining students end up in industry, and that industry is local. That means that a town like Tanjavur, a similar population, would have world-class industry in Germany. About 1 lakh population is the approximate cutoff where you can have actually a world-class company at about 1 lakh population. None of our towns with 1 lakh have anything like that today, right? Which is why the talent is escaping those places. When the talent wants to work in something world-class, you cannot stay in Tanjavur. You have to leave. You cannot stay in Tenkasi where we have an office. That's why we want to change it. That's why we put an office in Tenkasi. And this, I've been saying this, and I was given a tour of the biotech lab. There's two sophisticated equipment, advanced equipment that's there in your labs here. One from a company, I believe it's called Bruker, German. The other is called Geol, J-E-O-L, Bruker and Geol. One of them is German, and the other is Japanese. That's exactly what I expected. That's what I expected to see. I asked them specifically because I knew that must be Germany and the Geol must be Japanese or Korean. I would have guessed Japanese or Korean. And then I asked one of your alumni here, Ram Prakash, to go and research it for me, those companies. Thanks to the power of the smartphone, he went and found out. Sure enough, these companies are based in towns of about 1 lakh in Germany and in Japan. So these companies are able to export equipment worth several crores to a university in India. Think about that. This company based in Germany is selling some equipment worth 2 or 3 crores to a university in Tanjavur. What are we able to do in return to them? Right? In fact, if you look at your smartphone today, none of the components in your smartphone is actually made in India. Nothing. Not the processor, not the camera, not the glass, not even the case. Not even the case you buy, that's usually made in China. And not even the machines that make the case. Those are made in Taiwan or Germany. Then what do we actually export? For the most part, for a good number, good part now, in this technology industry, we are only exporting talent when we are importing all the technologies. So this is the equation. We export talent, import technology. So we go and make the technology somewhere else. But as I mentioned in the beginning, that has a serious problem. The problem is the technology creation job creates 5 jobs, maybe 10 jobs for non-technology creators. And those jobs are even more needed than technology creation jobs. Our country's biggest problem is youth unemployment. Fortunately, none of you are going to be unemployed thanks to a great education in Sastra University. But that cannot be said about people from your villages, from your towns. There's numerous people who are not going to be employed, But if your high-tech job stayed here, they would have found employment. So that is the entire, you know, philosophy behind our Zoho University model, that we wanted to create industry here, train the talent here to work on these technology jobs, and then through that indirectly create other jobs. So that's the entire philosophy behind it, and I'm happy to say that it works. This is one of the things I always thought of as life as a series of experiments, science projects. I didn't know it'll work. When we started it, I did not know it'll work. We tried it, we find that it actually worked, we scale it up. Then we try some other idea, scale, it works, scale it up. Some idea we try, it doesn't work, we try something else. So that experimental flavor. So that's what, again, I will advise all of you young to get that experimental flavor in your head. Nothing is, I mean, this is one of the, I mentioned Anglo-Saxon education. One of our educational problems is we don't have enough experimentation, we have too much theory. That was my own problem with my IIT education. I remember sitting in class in IIT thinking that something is missing for me, something is missing here. I only much later found out what was missing. This is how I summarize it, this last example. How do you go learn a bicycle? It's obvious, right? You get on the bicycle, fall down, get on it again, fall down, eventually you learn to ride it. A lot of our education system, on the other hand, is like you will be taught a bicycle in a classroom, draw all the parts, label them, learn all the physics of the bicycle, learn all the mechanical engineering of the bicycle. Maybe in the end, in a practical class, you will actually get on a bicycle. That's not even required to pass the bicycle class. Unfortunately, this methodology has to be changed. And the German way and the Japanese way is to get on the bicycle first. And what it means is a lot more students can access learning to ride the bicycle than learn about the bicycle. So the talent that you think is not smart enough to learn the physics of the bicycle can actually learn to ride the bicycle. We all know that, right? Everybody learns to ride the bicycle. This is true in software. A lot more people can write code than people can pass the computer science exam. So we decided you don't have to pass a computer science exam, you can still write code. We will test you directly on how to write code. We'll teach you how to write code and we'll test you on writing code. And we found that it works. We found that that methodology actually works. So with that, I've given you a lot of things to think over. Only one last tip for you, young minds here. Regardless of your station in life, regardless of whether you're a student, whether you're a CEO, whether you're a president, anybody, you have only 24 hours in a day. And as you grow older, you realize how valuable time is. I sometimes feel that, man, half my life is over. Have I done enough with it? Right? So time is the only thing you have, actually. Money can buy lots of things, money cannot buy time. Money cannot buy you time, right? And this you know. Here's the thing interesting about time. The quality of thinking you do in the time is about the only thing I know that separates the successful from the not successful. What do I mean by quality of thinking? It means that what type of thoughts are going on in your head? You could spend 3 hours getting angry at another person. You can spend an entire day being disappointed about something. Those are also thoughts in our head, because those thoughts are useless thoughts. If I watch the biotech lab today and I think about it, I'm going to think about it when I'm driving back home today. That thought might spark some ideas. And from that idea is how actions happen. That action could lead to somewhere, right? I'm going to do serious thinking on it. And all I will advise you is use your time wisely. Learn to, in other words, purge all these unproductive, useless thoughts, angry thoughts, resentful thoughts, or sad thoughts, all of that. Find a way to use quality, put quality thoughts in your head. Fill your head with quality thoughts. That will be the last piece of advice. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Revered convocation orator, sir. Distinguished senior colleagues on the dais, my faculty colleagues, invitees, proud graduates, their parents, ladies and gentlemen, I'm extremely happy today and with a very deep sense of gratitude would like to thank all of you, in particular Dr. Sridhar Vembu, for coming together to make this 31st convocation of Shastra University a grand success. You all deserve a big round of applause, sir. My happiness doubles on the realization. You want to say a few words? Okay, I'll reserve my thanks later.
First, I want to congratulate all the degree awardees. Your life journey begins today. 10 years later, I want to come back and I hope I don't have to give the same speech again. I hope there will be a lot of jobs and I hope you graduating today will be instrumental in many of those jobs. Okay, that's what I really hope many of you go on to do. Thank you. And I'll be around to interact with you informally after this thing and without the gown, so you can talk to me. Thank you.
In fact, you have made my job easier, but nevertheless, good things need repetition. So I will reiterate the points as I proceed with my vote of thanks. I just said my happiness doubled because I just realized that what we saw here was a very rare convergence, as the Vice Chancellor pointed out in his welcome address. A convergence of sorts which led to some osmotic transfer, new learnings for the convocation orator himself when he came to Shastra University in a very remote place in Thanjavur district, which is supposed to be an intellectually fertile soil, and found that the work that we are doing in nanotechnology, biotechnology was outstanding. And the learning was osmotic because as graduates, you also take back with you a valuable piece of message from the convocation orator. And that is why I believe that this convergence is a convergence of sorts that saw the meeting of proven success and potential success. Proven success that manifested in the form of Dr. Sridhar Vembu, who from a remote village, Chidambaranathapuram, went to California, sea to sea, and defined, or rather redefined, the competitiveness of the Indian IT industry through three I's which he captured so stealthily in his convocation address. A multidimensional intellect, a very rare combination of intellect that covered different dimensions, that built a globally competitive institution, that put India in the global IT map. And sir, I must share a personal experience that I relate with Zoho whenever I see the brand Zoho. A decade back, I was just walking through the international gates of the JFK airport in New York City. And I used to see all these global brands, Nike, the Swiss watch brands, various brands, Coca-Cola, all these global brands, and ask the question myself, when will a day come where I can see an Indian brand in such international airports? I'm not building a story, this is a true experience. 5 years later, same airport, I saw Zoho in the advertisement hoarding. Made in India, made for the world. And that day, I really mean it, sir, that day, I felt so happy that here we have a very powerful Indian brand occupying the global market stage. And all this was possible because of the three I's that I mentioned. The arithmetic sum of his intellect in building an institution for India, all this added, minus another big I, that it was I who did it. He never believed in that. He believed that it was the family members of Zoho and the stakeholders supporting the Zoho ecosystem that resulted in such a huge, successful global enterprise. And this, in my view, is a very profound message that as young graduates, you have to pick. Because in his convocation address, you saw how passionate in his appeal making, that he wanted to see, and that's what he also offered in his concluding remarks, that he wanted to see 10 years from now, when he comes to Shastra, which you have promised, sir, 10 years from now, that he will definitely see an empowered and economically developed ecosystem in and around the neighborhood of Thanjavur district. And I'm sure I see some graduates here who already feel that their positive energy has been stoked with this spirit of community entrepreneurship. Last convocation, we learned something new, entrepreneurial nationalism. And this convocation, adding a new dimension to that, is a spirit of community-based entrepreneurship, which I think is a very profound message that as young graduates, you have to take back, holding it very close to your heart and making a promise today that definitely 10 years from now, though I will not expect a voluminous set of entrepreneurs, but at least a bundle of talent who will make this Thanjavur and its neighborhood district an economically vibrant one. Thank you very much, sir, for those tons of wisdom and advice to these young graduates, sir. And I'm sure you will live up to those expectations. Congratulations to the graduates, and thank you, the parents of the graduates who have placed confidence in this institution, and I'm sure you are convinced that we have lived up to your expectations, and we continue to learn from new suggestions and feedback that you might have to share with us. I thank all the members of my faculty group, all the organizing committee members, friends from the electronic and print media for coming together to make this convocation a grand success. Thank you very much.